I'll do the one, two, three.
That's a tease.
What? That might need to, like, shift.
Not. Can you push that back?
Who's going to do that with me?
There we go.
One, two, three. All right. Is everybody ready for many more nuggets of inspiration?
Yes.
Well, no pressure there. So we have the founder of the locker room, who is Jake Dixon. He's everybody's daddy right now.
So,
so give it up, everybody. Let's give a very warm locker room welcome to Jake Dixon.
Well, thank you very much. I was just talking to Matt. This is, like, really surreal for me, just to be invited to, like, in a weird way, our own event. And thank you for Mary Lou and all the other Triangle coaches for putting this together. This is awesome. And like I said, this is pretty special. I hope you guys understand that and are taking some good notes. It's a tough act to follow. I don't have to say this. I know some instructors do say this, but to follow Matt and Cassandra and what they just did there, I'm a little intimidated, so I hope this is okay. But I'm going to take a different approach with this, if that's okay. I'm not going to really spend a whole lot of time, because you guys hear enough of that potentially from me, about building businesses. So with the theme of this morning being own your life, own your business, those of you who have been part of the locker room for enough, maybe since at least August, I think is when I did this, on one of our huddle calls, by the way, Wednesdays at 3 p.m., you know what I'm talking about when I say the huddle calls?
Yes.
And yes, we're probably going to make them Facebook Live videos now because of your overwhelming response. But I talked about this. So if you've heard this before, I apologize, but not really. Sorry, not sorry. It's okay if you hear it again. If you haven't heard this, the topic for today is going to be the five business principles that sports, specifically baseball, has taught me. And so when I originally came up with this content, it was hard because I don't, like Cassandra and Matt, believe it or not, I don't like to talk about myself very much. I like to talk, but not about myself a lot. So when I was running through this and I asked my wife, like, is this going to be okay? I don't want you to hear this as, oh, how wonderful we are. And I want you to see yourselves in our stories and how what you can take from these stories and apply to your own self. Is that fair? Okay. And I'm very sensitive to that, because if I don't say that, I'll just feel like I'm up here bragging and talking, and that's not what I like to do. So I'm serious when I say that. Before I get rolling, though, this is really cool because some of you may or may not know this. Briar Creek, even though this is a new office, was the very first expansion location for the locker room. Did you know that? Isn't that cool? So Mary Lou and Gina and their belief that they had in us from day one has paved the way for so many other offices. And right now, I believe, God, I lost count, let's just call over 30 offices that the locker room is now represented in, which is really, really cool. And just for you travel buffs out there, yesterday we got a verbal commitment waiting on paperwork from Maui, Hawaii. So I'm just saying, you can have a write-off and go out to Maui. So pretty cool, right? Pretty cool, pretty cool. I told her I was going to do this. You don't have to stand up, you don't have to say anything. But Anne-Marie is here, so hi, Anne-Marie. Yes. And so Anne-Marie, some of you get the emails from her probably. She is part of our leadership team with the locker room. I think it's very important to put a face with the name. And she works tirelessly behind the scenes for all of you, as well as the coaches, obviously, to with the numbers tracking and all that stuff specifically. So I just want to give her a quick shout out. All right. So, like I said, I'm going to dive into the content here of the five things, the five principles that I believe baseball specifically has taught me. And through these, we talk about defining moments. How do I work with this thing? There we go. Defining moments in life. And so if I had a conversation with each and every one of you, I guarantee if we peel back the layers of the onion, pull back the curtain, there's things in all of our lives that you can look backwards and say, yep, that was a defining moment in my life. And for a lot of people, it was in a face of adversity. Right? You'll see where I'm going with this here in a minute. But what are those defining moments in your life? And sometimes, as we say, and I'm going to get into, we're not a product of our circumstances. We are a product of our decisions and our actions. Would you agree with that?
Yes.
Okay. And so it's what we choose to do in the face of some of those challenges and adversities that really defines who we are. And when they say things, that hit me too, when Gary Keller stood on stage that day and he said, you are no more than 5 years from being anywhere you want to be in this life. That's true, y'all. That's really true. So I don't know your current situations. I hope to. But wherever it is you are, and whatever drunk monkey and story you're maybe telling yourselves and the excuses that you're coming up with, you got to kick it to the curb. People like Matt, Cassandra, and what we're doing here, we did it anyway. And so that's what I want you to see in the stories I'm going to share with you today. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to share the five principles that I believe it taught me and some defining moments or some things that happened to cause me to realize that. Okay, it'll make more sense here in a minute. So not to talk about myself, but to tee it up, yes, I played baseball. So I'm sorry if I know I'm giant here, if I'm blocking your view, look over there. But I began playing at age 5, as my mom tells the story way better than I can, and she says that I went to T-ball. Kicking and screaming, did not want to play. I know that's probably not an uncommon story for many of us, that we just didn't want to do something. But the point in that is she pushed me outside of my comfort zone, even at age 5, to do something that I didn't want to do and participate. And I'm so grateful for that, because that blazed the trail and is a large reason why I'm standing in front of you today. So I'm originally from Oneida, Illinois. Anybody know where Oneida is? You're lying if you say yes. It's a town of 700 people, literally in the middle of the sticks, the cornfields, bean fields on both sides of you. We had to travel 30 minutes just to get to a McDonald's or a Walmart. There's no stoplights in town. It's a speck on the map, right? It's no Raleigh, North Carolina, that's for sure. And I say that because I went to Rova High School, R-O-W-V-A, and it was representative of every little small town, Rio, Oneida, which is where I live, Watauga, Victoria, and Altona. So we all came together, we merged these small towns together to form a high school called Rova. And the high school had 200 kids in it total, 50 in my graduating class, and it was just small town life, and it was a great life. I had a great childhood. I don't have the rags to riches story. It was just a good upbringing, small town USA. So, and this will all make sense, I promise you. When I became a freshman, because baseball was a passion, and by then it was just what I wanted to do with my life, I thought, we didn't have it as a school sport. And so my parents, along with many others in the community, fought hard, went to the school board to adopt baseball as a school sport. Otherwise, we were not even kidding around. We were going to move to Bloomington, Illinois, so I could go to Bloomington Normal High School if Rova didn't adopt baseball as a school sport. And luckily, they did. And I remember the community all came together. There was a cornfield right by the high school that we wiped out. I'm not kidding. That we wiped out. And they built a baseball field. What am I doing? They built a baseball field on that cornfield, and it still stands there today. And it was all 100% volunteer. I remember getting out there and raking dirt and moving the ground up. So pretty interesting. So that's what I meant by against all odds. And there's some cool stuff about baseball. So anyway, why would I share this? As I said earlier, defining moments in your life. This is the key thing I want you to hear today. We are not a product of our circumstances, as I said before. Really, truly. I want that to sink. I'll do a long dramatic pause and let that marinate for a hot minute here. But it's not about what happens to us. It's about how we respond and what defining moments can you reference in your own life. Okay? That's what I want you to really think. Not just listen, but think about today as I'm going through mine. Okay. Gosh darn it. There we go. Success principle number one. So here's defining moment number one. And I'm going to do this through stories, but I promise I'll make the point. Okay, bear with me. So a lot of you, especially Anne Marie, have heard me say this a dozen times, but Joe, you heard me say it last night again. So sophomore year, this is defining moment number one for me. Tell me what you think after I say this, if you can relate with me. So it was my sophomore year of high school, and it was a playoff game. First playoff game, we were playing Sherrard, and a typical Midwest storm was coming through. It was the second inning, so lightning, everything. And then umpires ended up calling the game. They postponed it till the next day. And our high school coach at the time was not happy. I don't know why, to this day, why he was so pissed off. But he was not happy, and so he told us all, of course, to get the equipment up as soon as we could and rush into the gym. And long story short, when we got into the gym, he sat us all down, and he was just going to town, just ranting and raving about whatever it was that would come to his mind. And he got to me in front of my entire teammates, and he put his finger right in my face. He said, "None of you will ever see the inside of a college or pro stadium unless you buy a ticket." So, okay. All right, coach. I mean, that's supposed to be the person that's in your corner, right? He's one of your strongest advocates. We as coaches should be your strongest advocates. True? One of them. So the fact that he said, none of you will ever see the inside of a college or pro stadium unless you buy a ticket, would you agree that that's what a defining moment, a potential defining moment in life? Because you're faced with a decision. I could go left, I could go right. Left would say, you know what, coach, you're probably right, man. Nobody's ever gone on to do anything. We're in the sticks of Illinois. Who after all, would even travel here to come fight me, right? All these drunk monkeys. Or you could go right and say, no. I know my truth, right? I want to prove this guy wrong. Because I'm not going to let this ding-dong talk me out of my dream. Just because he gave up on his doesn't give him permission to talk me out of mine, right? And all of you probably have these same people in your life. Let's be real. You have people in your own lives. Maybe it's your spouse. I'm not picking on, you know. Maybe it's your mom, your dad, your best friend. Somebody in your life has told you that you can't do something. Maybe it's going on right now because you throw yourself and are vulnerable on Facebook and somebody's making comments saying, yeah, whatever. And I always use Cousin Eddie in my examples because it's Christmas vacation. So maybe it's Cousin Eddie talking and saying, you're doing what? You're getting into real estate? You're not going to see your first paycheck for 6 months. What are you talking about? You know what I'm saying? So that's where I want you to connect in the story. So here's business principle number one. Never let somebody else talk you out of your dream. Right? Simple stuff. But not so simple when you're actually faced with it and you're confronted with the challenge of overcoming it. If you can't tell, I'm kind of tall. And so when I had that moment of decision to make, I went all in. I don't know about you, that's how I operate. I'm all in. I stopped playing basketball. Wasn't a popular decision. I was pretty good. Wasn't a popular decision in the community, especially when don't have enough players as it is. Not to mention they lose a 6'6 guy. Right? Not popular. Had to go to the coach and create this uproar in the community. Don't care. Doing it anyways. I went all in with baseball. Going to the gym. started just committing myself to everything baseball, including in the winter. Going to the YMCA and working out and fielding ground balls in the gym area there and just doing whatever, okay? Because I wasn't going to leave it to chance. He could have been right. Could have fallen flat on my face. He might have been safe. Told you so, dude. You're not going anywhere. But I wasn't going to leave it to chance. Going to do everything in my power, at least, to prove him wrong. So, yeah, we already said that. Let the haters be your motivators. Love that. They're drinking their haterade. You don't know what I'm talking about. So what do you have to prove? And that, to me, is I love, instead of that drunk monkey sitting on your shoulder, why don't you have a chip on your shoulder? For me, that's a massive motivator. When we're talking about big whys, guys, don't overcomplicate this. For many of you, yes, it's your family. It's to fulfill your greatness. I get all that. To be honest with you, for a long time, and I still play this way, I just like to prove people wrong. I want the haters. If I'm not doing something of significance, then nobody's going to be hating on me. Do I have haters right now? Oh, yeah. You better believe it. And I welcome it. It's sick. It's probably, you know, weird, but I like it. It motivates me. So play with the chip on your shoulder instead of walking around fearful, wondering what other people are thinking about you and letting that fear dictate your life. Okay? I'm not done with this subject yet. In the face of adversity, what do you choose? Faith or fear? You choose. Both are believing in something that you cannot see. So which is it? I don't know about you, but at the end of the day, I'm going to bet on yourself, right? I didn't need that guy to get me seen. I'll go to showcases. I'll just let my performance on the field do the talking. If he doesn't believe in me, that's okay. My parents have enough belief in me, and they always have, and that's all I needed. So I love that quote. Are you going to advance boldly in the direction of your dreams or retreat fearfully into a world of mediocrity? You guys, there's enough followers in this world. This world needs leaders, if you can't tell. Turn on the news for once. I can't even turn on. I don't watch that crap. I don't want to fill my mind with it. Right? Be a leader. And a leader means stepping out in faith, doing it anyways in the face of adversity, and willing to take some heat for that. Leadership can be lonely. And by the way, I keep using this word leadership. If you don't think you're a leader, you need to check yourself at the door. If you're a parent, a spouse, a member of a church, you're in business, leadership is influence, nothing more, nothing less. If you're influencing people, congratulations, you're a leader. And I think everybody in this room is probably influencing somebody somewhere, somehow, right? So I'm not saying leadership is a title or a positional rank. This is not leadership. You have to earn the leadership because what's that thing? If I'm a quote person, okay? If you think you're a leader and you're and you take a walk and nobody, no, I'm sorry, if you take your leader and you turn around and nobody's following you, then you're merely taking a walk. Think about it. So, aha moment 2 years ago, listening to a story. Yeah, okay, that's my reminder for talking points. So, all that being said, moral of the story was, yes, got a full ride scholarship to play baseball, got drafted out of high school, Little Podunk, USA, in the 18th round by the Oakland A's. I turned that down to go on a full ride scholarship to Florida to play college baseball, and then I got drafted out of my junior year of college as a pitcher that time by the Angels. So, for the longest time, I had made presentations to, actually one of them was even a elementary school like athletic banquet. I've talked at junior highs and high schools, and I've always told the story, much more detailed, but I've always told that story. And it stopped there. I'm like, ha ha, nana boo boo, did it anyways, and it ended. Until 2 years ago, I'm an audiobook junkie, and I'm listening to The Storyteller's Secret. Check it out sometime. Has anybody ever heard of TED Talks? That's what this book is about. It's kind of like the presentation secrets of Steve Jobs and that kind of deal. But it tells how to tell your story in an articulate and captivating manner. All right? It's fascinating. Anyways, here's my point. So I'm listening to that, and I had my own aha 2 years ago. I was actually in Garner at the time. Where my Garner be? Yep. I remember where I was. This is the McDonald's on whatever that 51 Benson.
Highway 15 Timber Drive.
Yeah, that one. Right there. Seriously, I remember the dang moment. Is that okay? I don't even know. But I remember the moment. I was listening to this thing. And here's what I realized, you guys. Here's the biggest point of all, I guess. What I realized that day, 2 years ago, was the story didn't end there. What that did, that day, way back in my junior year of high school, was it lit the flame inside of me. There's something that triggered that day, which is why I'm standing in front of you right now. Because I refuse. I am wildly obsessed with helping people achieve their greatness. Obsessed is the word I'm going to stress here. I am obsessed. It's okay to be obsessive about certain things. But it lit the flame, and I will never, ever, ever be that person who says you can't do something. If you ever, I don't know many of you, but if you ever need some belief because you don't have enough in your, talk to your coach, call me, Facebook, whatever you need to do, I promise you we've got enough belief in you if you need to borrow some. Because every single one of us is born unique creatures in this world, and you have a unique set of gifts and talents that you just may or may not understand and have maximized yet. So that day for me, there was a gift inside of that. Now, yeah, I still play with a chip, and I'll never let that day go. I'm like, thanks, coach, appreciate that. But the gift was that I could now look back and actually appreciate and connect the dots to, it lit that flame. So even though I didn't understand it at the moment, a lot of you are maybe facing things right now in your lives that are a little chaotic, and you don't understand why this is happening to you. You don't probably understand that until you can look backwards and connect the dots. Right? Makes you stronger. But you got to take the time and look backwards and connect the dots and say, how is this making me better? How is this going to serve me in the future? Right? And now I get it. That was a gift from God. I don't know your spiritual beliefs. My belief system is that was a gift from God that day. I didn't understand it for years, until 2 years ago. Now I understand. Without that, probably wouldn't be here today. Seriously. So I'm very grateful for that. Okay, principle number two, here's the defining moment. Legion summer baseball game. All right, so again, I'm full of stories, so bear with me today. But this, I think people see themselves in stories. That's why I'm doing this. So, it was the summer after my junior year of high school, so before my senior year, and I'm in Farmington, Illinois, playing an American Legion baseball game over the summer. Okay, real small town, same deal. And before the game, I'm pitching that day. Before the game, there's a gentleman over here who I knew. He was from Bradley University, his head coach named Dewey Helmer from Bradley University. He was there to check me out. And so, cool, there's a scout in the stands, awesome. But as I'm getting ready, and I'm warming up, and this other gentleman walks down with a straw hat on, I'm like, all right, he's not a parent. You know, if you know sports, like, you can tell that dude is a scout, and that's just a parent. This was somebody that I did not know who the heck they were, but I wanted to find out. Long story short, fast forward, I pitched a complete game, one hitter, hit two home runs that game, and had an awesome, one of the best games of my life there. So he comes down to introduce himself to me after the game, shakes my hand, and says, Jake, great game, buddy. I'm like, cool. he said, my name's, oh God, I can't remember his name. I didn't put it on there. Doesn't matter. My name's whatever. And he says, I'm with the Major League Scouting Bureau. I'm like, what the hell, Major League Scouting Bureau? Come to find out, sounds good, yeah. He, whatever his name is at the moment, was in the, he was driving from Chicago down to St. Louis. And we were kind of in the middle there. He's telling me this. He saw lights on at a baseball field and just pulled over to go check out a game.
Wow.
Can you believe this? And I have one of the best games of my life right in front of this guy. And he comes up to me and shakes my hand and says, unbelievable. Great game. My name's whatever. I'm with the Major League Scouting Bureau. I represent all 30 Major League teams. That's what we do. There's only a few of us out there in the United States. And I just happen to pull over and catch a game on my way down to St. Louis tonight. Holy cow, you guys. So success principle number two is you never know who's watching. Hear this now. You never know who's watching. The right game, whatever game is, in front of the right person can change your life forever. What if that game, forget if I had a good game or not, but pure, no, let me rephrase that. Let's say I had that game. But one time when I wanted to throw a little pity party for myself because I struck out, and I'm throwing my helmet and kicking dirt, or I didn't run my ass, yes, I cussed, by the way, all the way through first base on a ground ball, he could have just ripped me off the list and moving on down the road back to St. Louis. I would have given him every reason, just like buyers going to a home looking for reasons not to buy, by the way. That's how a scout would approach it. I'm looking for every reason that I don't want to like this kid. Don't give anybody a reason. You never know who's watching. And by the way, that applies to parenting. What example are you role modeling for the people that you, y'all, people are watching you. Kids, if you have kids, are watching you. Everything you do, everything you say. If you don't have kids or they're grown up now, if you're out there on social media, people are watching you. They are. They want nothing more, and I think people are good-hearted by nature, but we find jealousy in things. They want nothing more to come to you in 6 months to see. Cousin Eddie here, I told you so. You were crazy. You should have listened to me. Right? Don't give reason people to say that. You never know who's watching. It's the hustle. It's the grit. What did I just do? Did I click it? No. It's the determination. It's a choice. So what are you choosing to do? How are you choosing to show up every single day? Many of you say, I want to earn $100,000. Cool. Awesome. I'm all for it. I'll give you any goal as long as we can chart the course to get there. But are your actions and habits, is your calendar matching that of a person who earns $100,000 a year? Yes or no? Right? You don't have to answer that. And I broke it down on the Locker Room Nation page a couple weeks ago and saying basically it ended up being like $400 a day. Are you earning $400 a day, 250 days a year? So I gave you even some vacation time and some weekends. And if not, you're not on pace. You're not tracking to earn $100,000. Do the math. One big math equation. And so it's a choice. And I said earlier, if I didn't run out of ground ball, i.e. contacts for you, talked about this last night at a different event that I did. Let's take Bold, for example, or Ignite even. Let's do Ignite. So if my goal in Ignite is, as you know, what is it? Daily what? The daily 10-4. So one of those items is making 10 contacts a day, right? Well, how are you choosing to show up? You making those 10? Did you call it a day at 9? I was talking to Joe in the hotel lobby last night. Joe, I'm going to make my point first and I'll share that. Nobody's watching you. You can't carry around a coach in your pocket every second of the day. As Matt said, it's on you at the end of the day. You got to put in the work. We can chart the course. I can hold you accountable. But how do I know really truly with the numbers you report or tell me if you're lying or not? I don't. That's a character thing. That's an integrity thing. What are you doing when nobody's watching? Did you not run out the ground ball and giving somebody who might have been watching a reason not to give you a chance and an opportunity? Because you only made 9 contacts out of 10? Because it's been a long day. Everybody else has said no. I've gotten voicemails. What's one more call going to really do for me? Mm-hmm. Have you heard the 212 degrees thing? Okay. Well, what's important about 212 degrees? Boiling point of water, right? Boiling point of water. So at 211 degrees, it's just really, really freaking hot water. Don't touch it. But that one extra degree that one extra little ounce of effort could be the game changer. Could have been the game of your life in front of the right person, for example. And as I'm talking to Joe in the hotel lobby, this was a true story. He had a goal to make 20 a day, or 20 contacts, 20 FSBOs. Yeah, during bowl. Call it a day, man. He was packing up. He was going home. He had 19. True story. And he made the extra call. Anyways, you got a $700,000 listing out of it?
Yeah, I got a $700,000 listing on FSBO. And that FSBO turned into an additional $1.6 million.
Can't make this stuff up. I have my own example. Tony Brown in our market center. Example after example after example. Is that you? How are you showing up? What if you throw your helmet, like I said earlier, and I'm and pout? That's what throwing helmets and kicking dirt is. You're pouting. That's a victim. Are you a professional victim? I can't help you as a coach if you're a professional victim. Check up from the neck up. Don't answer that. Don't know you. Well, who else, by the way, get over yourself. Can I be real? Get over yourself. Who else is sacrificing because of your choices or lack of activity? Because you don't want to get uncomfortable. And that's selfish, by the way. I don't want to pick up that phone because it looks like it weighs 10,000 pounds. I don't want to lead generate today. Well, guess what? Outside of you, who else does that impact? You have a family? Are you part of a church? You have a God-given right and a duty and obligation, if you read 10X, to make a whole bunch of money on. Money is not the root of all evil. Money does grow on trees. It's called a freaking profit share tree. Okay. So what gives? Get out of your own way. All right? You never know who's watching. And here, I'm going to continue with this. How do I know? I wouldn't ever preach, which I can have a tendency to do, or ask somebody to do something I've never done for myself, or at least wouldn't be willing to do myself. Another example of this, my OP. So I was you, sitting butt in the chairs. And my claim to fame is I've sold one home with Keller Williams. You guys really have one home. Prior to that, several years prior to me getting back into real estate, I sold new construction for Lennar down in Jacksonville, Florida. In general brokerage, I shouldn't even be qualified to stand up here and speak in some of your minds because, well, he hasn't done that. He was never a mega agent. How can he coach? I sold one home during Ignite. Here's what happened. Never know who's watching. Keep this in mind. So we were part of a smaller market center. Quad Cities. Anybody familiar with Quad Cities? Rock Island, Bettendorf, Davenport, Iowa. That's where I'm kind of there. And so I'm going through Ignite, got my first deal. And my OP calls me two weeks after my first transaction. And her voicemail said, "Hey Jake, it's Donna here at the office. Need you to call me back." Like, totally vague voicemail. It's like, you ever receive that? I'm like, oh my God, am I getting sued? I have no idea what I'm doing. And so I call her back, and she's like, "It's all good. Just calm down. Just come in my office Monday morning. I want to talk to you about something." I'm like, okay. So anyway, she starts telling me about this team leader opportunity. I'm like, nah, I'm the new guy. I sold one home. What are you talking about? Because at the time, our team leader wanted to step back and get into production. It wasn't her gig. And she had, here's her words, observed my participation in class. And, also her words, she Facebook stalked me for 2 months. Because she had saw I did some other things. I ran a business and did some network marketing stuff. So I could build, I could recruit and do that. So anyway, we go through the thing, and right there's a defining moment in and of itself. Took the TL opportunity, became a team leader for 2 years for the Quad Cities, did really good, moved to Cary, North Carolina for a bigger opportunity as team leader, which is how I got to know many of you. And here we are now, a coach in Fort Mill, South Carolina. You never know who's watching. How else can I convince you other than authentic stories like that? Who's watching you? How are you showing up? All right. How are we doing? Good so far?
Yep.
A lot of stairs. So success principle number 3, but here's the defining moment first. Arm injury. I got a big old scar right there. I don't know if you can see it. So I had Tommy John surgery as a pitcher. So I had my surgery my junior year of college, 16 months of rehab before picking up a baseball again. And I never quite got it. It just messes with the feel and grip and came back throwing harder, but just never was quite right. Kind of felt out of sync ever since then. But anyway, got drafted, and played with the Angels. And then my very first damn year in pro ball, I did it again. I remember it. I was out in Idaho, Falls, Idaho, and in the middle of the game, felt it go. I'm like, oh God, I know that feeling. And I had always promised myself and my parents, don't say this, pray. I always promised my parents and myself I wouldn't get a second surgery. I mean, at that point, if I did rehab it again and go under the knife, it's another 16 months, and by then you're a 23, 24-year-old rookie, which is considered old, by the way, because they're always bringing in fresh talent each year. You with me? So I called it quits, and that was that. Now, because I remember this so clearly, it was actually the 4th of July, 2006. We were in Idaho Falls. I remember that game, and at the end of it, when we got back to the hotel, all the other players were getting off the bus and everything, and I waited because Tom Kochman, the manager, was on the front, and he always waited last too. So I go up to Coach and I say, Coach, can I talk to you for a second? And I lost it. I'm not ashamed. I cried. Okay, I lost it, and he just looked up and he's like, "It's your arm, isn't it?" I'm like, "Yeah, come on." So he's like, "Go." Gain composure, do what you need to do, and let's talk. Let's just finish out this road trip, and we'll talk when we get home. But right there, I knew in an instant, it's over. Done. Everything I thought I was going to do, and that ding-dong coach back in sophomore year of high school, done. Which is okay, right? But I'll never forget, I just curled up like in the fetal position outside the hotel for hours, and just thinking and processing and called my parents and everything, and it was hard. You know, what you thought you were going to do and the path you were on ripped away just like that. And this isn't a sob story, I'm going to make my point. Right there, number three, adversity makes you stronger. Adversity makes you stronger. I said this earlier, do you choose faith or fear? Both of you can't see them. You're believing in something. So which is it? Fear often makes a lot of our short-term decisions for us, which impacts the long-term outcome. So in that moment, like I said, you can't always make sense of things, why they happen, the timing of which they happen. It's only later looking back when you can connect those dots. What did I say there? Maybe right now you're wondering why hasn't biz... Oh, yeah, I'm just relating with you. So maybe right now in your own lives, you're wondering why hasn't business come quicker? I've been going at this and going at this for 5 months and I still haven't had an appointment yet. What's wrong with me? Okay, some of that internal dialogue begins to happen. You start thinking, are my efforts going to lead to business? Why is everybody else succeeding? And they're running laps around me, and I'm just sitting here trying to get my first lead. What's going on? I begin to compare my insides to other people's outsides. You know who you are. It's very normal, by the way. There's no judgment. I do it too. We all do it. It's normal human behavior. But I do believe everything happens for a reason. I believe that day, now that I understand it, I was very bitter about the game of baseball for 2 years. Until I got asked to coach a 12U team down in Florida. I'm like, okay, I think I'm ready to get back in baseball to some degree. I just needed a break. I was burnt out. I was mad. I was bitter, all that. But, again, how can this serve me in the future should be a question that you often ask yourself. Whatever junk I'm going through, if you have faith, it's hitting you for a reason. Don't they say, if you're not currently in a state of chaos, you either just left it or you're getting ready to go in it. That's life. So life is going to throw you curveballs, so to speak, if we're using baseball stuff. But here's the deal. Stay committed to the process. You heard a lot of people. My coaching style is, do I want you dreaming big and thinking big and all those things? You betcha. I really do. But once we set the goal, and Matt talked about this a little bit too, there's the goal and there's the commitment. I'm really more interested in it from my coaching perspective than consistency, because I know consistency wins championships. So once I've got done thinking big and I've set my goals, now I want you to shift your thinking to think consistent. Are you committed to the process of doing what you said you wanted to do? That's the kicker, y'all. That's why 8 out of 10 people aren't in the business anymore in 2 years. True. It is. Because they thought it was all roses and HGTV and all that stuff, and it's not. If you haven't figured this out yet, it's not. But consistency plus persistency equals success. It's not always about the destination. I know that kind of is cheesy. We've heard this a lot before, but it's really not. It's not about the destination. The journey does matter. You know, if you have played sports, I'm just going to stay on that theme. What if at the beginning of the year, I just come to your team, if you're the coach, and I say, boom, here's this trophy. Congratulations, you won the championship. And probably there's going to be a 20 minutes worth of celebration. It's like, what? Okay, that's cool. That's a material thing. I like that recognition that I just got. We are the champions. But then you're going to have that aha moment as a coach and all your players say, well, wait a minute. We haven't even practiced. We haven't even played a game. What did we do to earn this? So I'm telling you right now, the journey matters. The point of setting a goal is not necessarily to hit the goal. It's the person you become along the way of attaining that. So what doesn't kill you makes you stronger sort of thing, right? What can you learn? Life is going to zip by you like this, so slow it down a little bit. Right? I'm not saying go through the motions. This isn't a dress rehearsal. But slow it down. Don't the greatest players, the ones who are making millions of dollars on TV, you'll hear in their interviews that they say, the game slows down for me. And it's like, well, what does it mean? Because I'm watching it on TV, and you're going, N-n-n-n-n-n. But they practice, they've hustled, they've been there a million times before, that in their world, because now it's just on instinct, and then go left, go right on a dime, the game slows down. Your real estate game, by the way, I use this analogy a lot, the blocking and the tackling of this business, which is called lead generation, lead follow-up, go on appointments, negotiate contracts, script and role play. How'd I do? That the blocking and tackling of this business never changes. Never changes. You're going to want to sprinkle your own creativity on this at times, which is maybe okay, but the fundamentals of this real estate game never change. The only thing, like sports, that changes as you go up is the speed of the game. That's it. Speed of the game. Same way if I'm teaching a kid how to swing a bat or grip a baseball or whatever, what I teach him at 12 years old is the same freaking thing that those guys on TV making millions of dollars do. Competition gets better. I get it. The game speeds up. Instead of them throwing 45 miles an hour, now they're throwing 95 miles an hour. You got to react. And how do I react quickly? Because I've been conditioned. I've mastered it. And I can act like that. I don't have to think through it anymore. Is this making sense? Am I talking to anybody? Am I getting in there or something? Okay. Yeah. What's, by the way, thank you. Who can your story inspire? You all are creating your story right now. Maybe you're going to cap in your first year. I don't know. Maybe you're in your fifth year and you're like, dude, I've never closed more than five deals. I don't know. Whatever your story is, I have a story, Matt has a story, Cassandra has a story. We've shared some of that with you today. You, all of you, could stand right here and tell us your story. You've all got one. You may not be giving yourself credit for it, but you have one. And your story will inspire somebody. And that's just big old game of telephone, you know, that you'll never know. We'll never know the people that we've changed our lives. So what's your story? What are you creating? All right, number four, the defining moment. Endure the sacrifice to enjoy the reward. Let me tell you about this. So that's number four. Endure the sacrifice so you can enjoy the reward. Five by fives. I'm just going to run through these real quick. Oh, my God. And some of you, like Joe and Terrence isn't here, but some of you, this is like nothing for you football players or some other people in the room who might have been athletes or military and stuff like that who have been through the ringer, okay? So I'm just a sissy, and then this is hard for me. So five by fives. Okay, so for every year, we as a baseball team in college would have to run a five by fives for every loss we had the previous season. So if we had 20 losses last year, even though I wasn't even on the team, maybe as a freshman. Doesn't matter. For every loss we had the previous year, we had to run 25 5x5s. So what that is, after we get up at 4:30 in the morning lifting weights, we had to go out to the tennis courts. And on a tennis court, down, back, down, back, down is one. We had to do 25 of them suckers and then go run a mile. So not fun, right? And again, keep in mind, endure the sacrifice to enjoy the reward. Weights then class. Yeah, like I said, we had to wake up every day at 4:30 in the morning, go lift weights, and then you're done usually after running and all that by 7:30. You get back to your dorm, you shower, you grab your books, and you get off to your 8 o'clock class. And then by noon, you're done. You go to your 1 p.m. Practice for 3 hours. You go home, you study, you do your homework all the day, and do it over again tomorrow. Okay? not fun. The process of success sucks sometimes, right? Hell week, oh, 6 minute mile. 6 minute mile, so yep, every year, this, I got daddy long legs, so it was easy for me, but we had to run a 6 minute mile, every single player on the team. And if you didn't, literally every morning after weights, you went back to the track until you could do it. I'm not kidding. Like some of the bigger guys and less quick, fast twitch muscle fiber people, it was a struggle. They were on the struggle bus, but it's right here. It's right here. The slowest slug on our team did it. And it was like this just breakthrough moment for everybody to see that happen. If he can do it, I can do it sort of thing. Nobody said the 4 minute mile could be done until Roger Bannister did it. And then immediately 2 weeks later, more people started doing it. The 4 minute mile was impossible. Well, somebody did it, which paved the way for other people to do it too. Hell week, yep. So after I got done vegging out, going home for 2 weeks for Christmas, we knew the day we got back on campus, it was hell week. So you better not just chill like I did, like a potato on a couch. Yeah, a lot of the other guys were working out, but I didn't because I just wanted a break. But we had hell week. So for a week straight, 4 in the morning, we go out to the parking lot. We're running, and we calculated actually 8 miles a day is about what it ended up being. Just like it was a boot camp, just like military. It was a boot camp, hell week. Sore, people literally had stress fractures from it, puking in the parking lot. Sorry, I'm just, it was tough. I mean, anybody that's played knows what I'm talking about. And then finally, this is the best one of all. Sorry for this image, ladies. Flex off. This is how I can stand up here. I actually got a C minus in speech class in school. I was that guy reading from the paper and I didn't even care. I just want to pass. I was so shy and fearful of getting in front of people for public speaking. Funny how things change. Flex off, oh God. So again, right before we left for Christmas break, we had this little thing on campus. Basically, it's a little, how would I describe that? Like a clubhouse that's got a stage. Can you imagine hundreds of sorority girls coming to this event called the UNF Baseball Flex Off, where all of us ding-dongs had to rip our shirts. We're just in baseball shorts, and that's it. We got broken down into weight classes, and so we had to lather ourselves up with baby oil so we shine our face. I'm not kidding. I got pictures, actually. I didn't put them on here. And we had our own, so we had to do like group flexes, then we had our own 30 seconds in front of them. You got to go. You got to do the whole thing, right? And, oh God. It was so bad. I mean, there was guys throwing up because they were so nervous before having to go out there. It was so bad. But here's the thing. Here's the point. Success is boring. Unsexy, it's repetitious, it's hard freaking work, there's no shortcuts. Everything my college coach, he's a Hall of Fame coach, did, I know now was very calculated. And now I remember him talking about that flex off, and at the time I just wanted to strangle him. But he said, if you can do this, how scary is it to go on that job interview? Or you get laid off, and you got a family to provide for. He's like, guys, if you can do this, and get in front of a whole bunch of women screaming at you, you can do anything. He was right. He was right. There's a lot of personal growth that happened in that. But you need to understand this, and Gary Keller says this too. You just have to accept that success is just mundane. It's just doing the boring stuff over and over again, which is why a lot of us try to add our own creativity to it, when in reality, I just got to make 10 or 20 contacts a day. Whether you like it or not, I just got to be doing that. And I've earned the nickname Tot Tot by one of our coaching clients, because I always say time on task over time, which is back to that consistency thing. It's time on task over time. Be steady, be persistent, and consistent with it. Guys, you'll make more money or whatever your goal is than you can even imagine. Truly you will. Do you love the game enough that you're willing to go through the process? I said earlier, commit to the process. Do you love the game enough? For me, I love holding that ball on that mound so damn much that I'm willing to do all that hokey pokey stuff. I'm okay with it. What's your game? It's a listing presentation. It's a buyer consult. It's the closing. That's your game. Do you love that enough? Is it attached to a big why enough that you're willing to endure the process? Even if that means getting a little uncomfortable with baby oil all over you? Make the calls. Let me rephrase that. Make the contacts. I'm not an old school. It's got to be a phone call. But make the contacts. Okay? lead generation, script practice, you know what to do. A lot of you come to us coaches saying, well, I just don't know what to do. Be it. You know what to do. That's BS. That's an excuse. You know exactly what to do. You're just choosing not to do it because you don't want to get uncomfortable a little bit. Do you have a team to surround yourself with when things get bad? That's an accountability partner. That's a coach, right? Do you think we could have got through Hell Week or 6-minute miles and things like that without the team? No way. I mean, the guys were rallying behind us. Get through the finish line. You can do this. Get that extra rep in. Whatever it is, it's important to have people around you that are going to support you and encourage you. And I said this last night. There's two people in life, one that tears you down, one that builds you up. That's it. Are you choosing, choice, to surround yourself with people who are building you up? Because when it gets tough and you don't want to make that extra phone call, a true friend will tell you do it anyways. You've shared with me your big why. You've shared with me your goals. I remember the day and how passionate you were about that. I, as a friend or a coach, cannot let you not make that extra call because I know and I saw in the moment how emotional you got when you shared with what you wanted to get out of this with me. Good. You're the average of the top 5 people you associate with. Continue. No one succeeds alone. Success leaves clues. Everything we go through serves a greater purpose. Isn't that biblical? What did I say? To whom much is given, much is expected, or something like that? Scripture? It's true. Right? So whatever you're going through right now, if you're being tested and you're in that chaos, just know there's a greater good to that. You're proving to the man upstairs that you can handle it, and so he can bless you with more. All right. So do you accept it? Do you accept the preparation for your greatness? I hope so. And the only way of knowing that is you actually get out there and implement and do it. That shows us through action, not just talk, that you accepted it. Bring it on. I got some stories on that, but I won't. All right. Are you willing to take a stand for your greatness? Check this out. This is a coaching question. Are you willing to take a stand for your greatness more than you're willing to take a stand for your unlimiting beliefs? Think about it. What are you holding on to from the past that is no longer serving you in the present? These are coaching questions. Answer it in your head. Write it down. You don't have to shout it out. Those are powerful questions, you guys. Whether it makes sense now, or you may write it down and see it in your notebook in 6 months and say, holy cow, now I get it. I'm telling you. You want to archive those two questions right there. What am I doing? That's a little clearer. All right, last one. Defining moment number 5. Don't be late, and you better touch the line. This is talking about standards. Standards. So don't be late. So we knew every morning if we were a minute late to waits at 4:30 in the morning, that everybody was sent home. And I'll just say it wasn't pretty later in the afternoon of practice. So everybody, if one player was late, we all got there, had to wait around, and if coach says, where in the hell's Joey? Go home. Dude, how unhappy would the team be for that player, first of all, especially when we got to go now in the afternoon and run our butts off because of this guy couldn't wake up to an alarm clock, or his roommate didn't think to wake him up and he just left. Team, okay? All in or all out. What else? Oh, touch the line. Yep, back to those 5x5s. So I distinctly remember this morning, because remember, we had to do 25 5x5s. We were on number 23. 23. And you're going, a couple guys down. Didn't touch the line. About that far off the line. Cheated himself. Didn't touch the line, which is the thing to do. We started over at zero. Start over. Zero. Swear to God. Standards. There's another story I usually read. It's something to the effect of this old coach went to the ABCA, which is a baseball convention, and he shows up and he's got a home plate hanging on his neck. He's presenting, and everybody's kind of starting to chuckle. He's like, does this old man not know? He's got a home plate hanging around his neck. What's going on? And so he tells the story, and very long story short, he said, this is the problem in households today, in churches today, in work today. We live in this world where there's a lot of entitlement out there. And he said, the problem is, he asked all the coaches, if you're a Little League coach, how wide is home plate? And they're like, 17 inches? Yeah, yeah. Hey, if you're a high school coach, how wide is home plate? I think it's 17 inches, right? College coaches, 17 inches. Minor league coaches, 17 inches is the answer, y'all. I said, exactly. If a kid's out there and he's throwing and he's missing the plate, he can't throw a strike, does the umpire widen the plate? The plate's 17 inches. Throw a strike. Or get somebody else in there that can. So in our world, kids, as parents, or yourselves with your own standards and disciplines, are you widening home plate? Are you widening home plate? Standards matter. There's no such thing as a minimum standard. Don't, if you ever get the privilege of meeting Gary Keller, don't you dare ever in your language say minimum standard. There is no such thing. The standard is the standard. What the hell is a minimum standard? Right? What is your standard that you're willing to accept for yourself? Because whatever that is the same standard you're willing to accept of other people. You cannot complain about the things that you tolerate. You teach people how to treat you. So if you're saying things like, oh, call me anytime, and then you come to me as a coach and you're complaining that somebody's texting you and calling you at 11:30 at night, you set the expectation. I taught them how to treat me, so if you don't think your words matter, you're mistaken. Standards. What are your standards? Matt, Cassandra, they're very clear around what their standards are. Family first. They are the definition of God, family, and then business. Be present at home. Are you taking that call in the middle of dinner and saying, hang on, hon, I'm going to take that? Because you're so wrapped up in the fact that that's potentially $5,000 that you would lose out on. You're operating out of scarcity, not abundance. Be present. Put the phone away. There's no real estate emergencies. There's no such thing, especially if it's after hours. So yeah, hit on all that. Character, we said that earlier. What do you do when nobody's looking? I already said 212 degrees. I knew that was in here somewhere. Coaching question. What are you currently not doing that if you did do it, completely change the game? What is it? Tell on yourself a little bit. It's okay to tattle and be real with yourself when it comes to this. Some of us coaches would want to ask you, how am I going to know that you're hiding from me? First appointment, when we onboard you into the coaching program, that should come up. How am I going to know when you're hiding from me? Or what do I think you're doing that you're not really doing? Ouch! I'm leading you to believe I'm lead generating, but I'm really not. Okay. How's that working for you? Take pride in what you do. Always over-deliver. That's a 10X Grant Cardone thing. A lot of people say under-promise, over-deliver. Grant Cardone says, no, over-promise and over-deliver. What does that look like? And Gary Keller hits on that in the MREA book when he says, treat the source of the referral better than the referral itself. Now, you all know you're going to treat the referral itself good. You're customer service ninjas out there. But what does he mean when it says treat the source of the referral even better than the referral itself? It's like, is that even humanly possible? Because you're a rock star. He's saying acknowledge the behavior, just like our children. I want to reward behavior that I expect. The people that are referring you deals or business leads, they don't know if that person's pre-qualified. They have no idea. I wouldn't expect them to. So I owe them a thank you note. I owe them a personal phone call or a follow-up or whatever it is, even if it doesn't work out. Because I want to reward the activity and the behavior of them doing it again and again and again. It's my job to figure out if they can even qualify. I like this one. I use words like dominate and disrupt. So are you trying to compete or are you dominating? A lot of you are trying to compete with the neighbor or compete with a different company. I believe that there is no such thing as competition if you're just dominating. So get out there and dominate, disrupt your market, disrupt your database. Go against the grain, be different. You know, a lot of you have heard me say this like a broken record. I really do believe, the quickest way to success is observe what the masses are doing and do the exact opposite. Now, don't mishear that. You're getting nuggets. Matt and Cassandra are like, there's a breadcrumb path to follow. I'm not saying that. Yes, success leaves clues. But how can I take that and then add my own little creative spin to it so I'm different? And if for you that's open houses, man, blow up an open house. I want freaking clowns. I want bouncy houses. I want everything. So the whole neighborhood can see that you do open houses like nobody else. What's your gig? Own it, dominate it, disrupt it. Do it better than anybody else can do. And all of you are different with different talents and things, so probably all different answers. There's no one way. There's no put you in a box answer for this. All right, final exercise. So if you do have a piece of paper, if you don't, just think through it or note this or something. We don't have to do this right here, right now, completely, but I would say write down a time in your life, if you just even want to remember this, that you were successful. What? Think through it. At least humor me and think through that. What were the habits that you committed to that led to the success? Think back. Here's when I was successful. Backtrack. What was I doing? How much was it consuming my mind? Was I dedicated to my craft every day, every morning, every night? I was whatever it was. You know there was something behaviorally that led to that success moment you had that you're thinking of right now. What was your mindset like? I'll bet you weren't throwing pity parties. You were on top of the world. You were motivated. You didn't even have to wake up to an alarm clock. You couldn't wait to get out of bed because you were like, oh yeah, I'm going there. Okay? And who did you surround yourself with? I want you to think and ask yourself all those questions stemming from a time in your life that you would say, I was successful. Not somebody else saying, when were you successful? And by the way, for some of you, that might just mean, I had this chicken list, and I called all 10 people on my chicken list. I am so proud of myself for doing that. It doesn't have to be any like award or accolade or I made it story either. Okay. And then do the flip-flop. What's the time in your life when you failed? What self, check that out. Notice the words. What self-defeating habits were you practicing that led to that failure? What was your mindset like? Who were you hanging around? Is it true that misery loves company? Yes. So, if you can do that, or you're thinking through that, the final one then is, what did you write down? Truth-telling moment that's showing up right now in your real estate business. Is it from the success column? Is it from the failure column? I don't know. You get to self-discover that. But a time in your life when I was successful, a time in your life that not so successful, habits, mindset, who was I around, and then how is that showing up in your current world? I think I'm done. I'm done. Okay, cool. And I am not going to take questions. We're going to, are we going to panel and do questions then? Okay.
First, let's give them a hand, y'all. Woo! 11:30 exactly, so I'm going to talk fast. I'm going to give you a 5-minute break so we can set up for a panel. So while you're on this 5-minute break, and I do mean 5 minutes, showing back up on time, you're going to have the opportunity to talk to our three speakers. Think of the questions that you want to ask. Then at 12 o'clock, we'll hear from our sponsor, and we shall go to lunch. Any questions? Oh, and I'm going to have to count you off, which is, so I remember I'm telling you so I don't forget, but remind me to tell you to count off. Right? Any questions? Go. 5 minutes.
Yep.
Okay. Cool.